when you think about what happened in the last election in 2008, in 2008, President Obama, there were 130 million votes cast. And the coalition that President Obama put together was African Americans, Latinos, women, and young people. And let's just look at the age demographic numbers to start in particular. In 2008, 10% of the electorate was between the ages of 18 and 24. 16% of the electorate was 65 and over. In the last election in 2010, when Republicans were able to recapture the House, and there was a resounding Republican victory, there was 6% of the electorate was 18 to 24. It was 10% in 08, it was 6% in 2010. And 21% of the electorate was over the age of 65. When young people vote, they get to choose the leader that they want. When they don't vote, they have leaders chosen for them. So this election is going to really hinge on the turnout of this generation. And people may decide they don't really want President Obama anymore. But you should make that decision and not let other people make it for you. So with that, I am going to go to our panel. And since she was last, we're going to ask her to speak first. And then we'll work our way around the panel with just a couple of minutes of opening remarks from each one of you before we get to questions.
Hello again, everyone. My name is Brittany Foxhall. I'm a senior international business major from Detroit, Michigan, currently serving as your executive president here at Howard University. And, you know, I just really thought it was important that my voice was heard today because, as you all know, this is a very important, pivotal election year. And we each play such a big role in what's going to happen. And I just think being engaged and being a part of this election is so much more than just going out and vote. I think that, you know, as Howard University students, as Morehouse students, we are the premier universities for African Americans. And we're developing the leaders of tomorrow. And as the leaders of tomorrow, we should be informed and we should make informed decisions. So we should know the platform of the Republican Party. We should know the platform of the Democratic Party so we can make these informed decisions and have informed conversations with our peers and know what it is that we're speaking about and know what it is that we're actually voting for. So that's really what I want to push for and speak about today.
Thank you.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Henry Washington. I'm the 81st SGA president at Morehouse College. A special shout out to Spelman ladies that are present, to our sisters over there. Essentially, I want to implore everyone in this auditorium and everyone that may see this recording that essentially we have to be engaged. 2012 is a critical election. Since the time of President Obama's election, there have been several laws and actions taken to suppress this voice in this room of African-American youth, African-Americans in general, the elderly, those who change elections. We are here to send a resounding message that you may try to suppress this voice, but we will be heard.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Albert Sanders. I am counsel on the Senate Judiciary Committee for the chairman of the Subcommittee on the Constitution, Senator Dick Durbin, and I'm very happy to be here today behind enemy lines once again with Morehouse, but we've got a great welcome and looking forward to talking today. I hope that, and I know Jamal will lead us in that direction, that we'll talk a little bit about why it's important to vote. There are some people, probably some young people, though not any in this room, who may be thinking, well, why is it important for me to vote? Who may be thinking, well, you know, my vote really doesn't matter that much. Well, I'll start by leaving you with this thought. That is that there are plenty of millionaires and billionaires who are contributing to super PACs and many nationally known political strategists that are trying to do everything they can to make it harder for people like those gathered in this room to vote. Our committee has done an extensive set of hearings across the country, and what they indicate is that it's harder for young people, minorities, seniors, disabled folks, poor people, to vote as a result of laws that are being passed across the country. And so if you don't think your vote matters, and if young people across the country don't think their vote matters, all you have to do is look at what some folks in the opposition are doing. And we'll talk a little bit more about that today.
Roy. Good afternoon. Thank you for having me here. Let me say thanks to President of Morehouse College and thank you to Howard University for hosting this forum. I am a father, a husband, a friend, as many people as I can try to be a friend to. And over the last, say, 20 years or so, I've had some unique blessings. I've had an opportunity to see politics up close and personal serving at the executive level on the state level and serving at the legislative branch on the federal level. So hopefully this afternoon I can share a little bit of my experiences with you all. And most importantly, you know, now that I've been out of politics for almost 10 years, it's a different job. When you're in politics, your job is more of to market. You have a product, you have a candidate, you have a group of ideals and policies, and you market those to a constituency to try to move them from point A to point B. Now that I'm out of politics, I don't necessarily see that as my job anymore, so I can have a lot more fun with it in terms of I just want to educate and try to share with you all my experiences as I've gone through life.
Thank you. As a professor, I can't help but make some, I guess, fairly technical observations, but it's important to remember that it's almost a year to the day since the nation became aware of the grotesque and persistent inequality that Katrina showed us when we saw the visible evidence of an, quote, natural disaster brought into focus and aggravated by an unnatural political disaster and inequality. That led to, I think, a national consciousness that the direction of the administration at the period was not going correctly, and led eventually to a change of attitude towards that administration, encouraging 2 years later the Senate success of Obama, and at the same time a reaction. And that reaction gives us a special reason to think about electoral participation today. That in that same year, 2006, voting ID constrictions began to appear for the first time in modern times in state legislatures, and now they're all over. If we ever doubted why young people need to vote, I can give you a little number at the end that will show you how much of a difference it can make in the outcome of this next presidential election. But just for a moment, since I had prepared to talk a long time and I've been threatened with microphone cutting off if I go too far, let me just make some simple observations. Most of you have heard these already, but it bears putting them in the context to see the extent of the intent of sometimes a partisan nature, sometimes an ideological nature, to repress the independent expression of the black vote, and I think of the liberal white vote as well. First, there is a thing in many things in Ohio, such as the cutting off of early voting. There was an effort called Souls to Polls. Ohio was one of the critical state that put Bush over in 2004, and there were 50,000 votes that make a difference. Some people say the Souls to Poll effort was a chance for people to go from church to the polls. Well, the state secretary of state cut off, with local support, voting on Sunday. That way you keep down some black voting. In Pennsylvania, and you may have all heard this, the GOP legislative head bragged that by instituting constraints on voting, Romney was going to be put in office. In Florida, they produced a list of over 2,600 names of people who were ineligible to vote without checking. So many of those names were veterans and long-term voters, but it threatened the image of access and the fact of access for Hispanic voters as well. And there are innumerable states in which legislative activities that suggest a conscious disregard for free access to the vote has taken hold, that the reaction to the progress that we felt from 2006 to a few years ago has been concerted. And so what the difference is that number that puts us over the top in terms of those people who want to retain the values that we think the country is supposed to support in terms of electoral participation. 61% is a good number. That is the estimated number of all voters, not just registered voters, that is needed to get Obama reelected. 61% is also, by many, the estimated number of white voters needed to get Romney elected. Just one little point in this regard. Between 2004 and 2008, youth voters, black and Hispanic, went up almost 9%. And that 1% difference, if you just take that 1%, if Obama gets more votes than ever before, except last year, he will lose if that 1% goes. And that 1% is more than the 50,000 that carried Ohio, and it's a whole lot more than the 500 that carried Florida. So the vote may be in our hands.
Well, thanks for having me, and I want to thank Howard University and Morehouse. And the question is why vote? And I ask myself, why not vote? The millennial generation is faced with such, we're basically, if I could be frank, We're generation screwed. And the reason why we are generation screwed is because, look at the statistics. Most of us are graduating college with overwhelming amounts of student debt. Beyond that, most of us, instead of buying an apartment and going out and living the American dream, we're moving back in with our parents and we're sleeping in our Snoopy sheets. So we're dealing with all those situations as to reason why we should be the generation that is the most apt to vote. Because this election is going to be one of the most historical elections of our time. And I think a couple blocks from here is the United States Capitol. And if we saw what the Capitol has done in the past 2 years to young people, they objected to 3 million of us going back on our parents' health care insurance. They objected to us keeping the student loan interest rate on Stafford loans low. They've objected, and the Republican nominee says, well, if you want to go to college, you should shop around and find the best option. When has it been okay for you to shop around for your education? You should go to the best institution that your brain can get you to, right? And that's why this election matters. That's why this election is so important. And if we don't turn out and the election doesn't, we don't have our voice be heard, we'll be generation screwed again. And the reason for that is has everything to do with the fact that we've had the older folks run this, we've had them run this country. We had them run the country a couple years ago. The former president was part of the old guard and they drove us off the cliff. And if we are stupid enough to let them drive us off the cliff again or drive us lower into the cliff or in the ditch, I would say, we're gonna be in a really, really bad situation. So it's more imperative than ever before in this election for young people to come out, for us to vote, and beyond voting, it's about talking to our friends, our neighbors, our relatives, and our associates, I like to call them Fran, and telling them they should go vote too, because it's not one of us. We need to bring 5 people to the polls, 10 people to the polls, your roommate, your classmate, your boyfriend, your girlfriend. Everybody needs to go to the polls and vote in this election so our voice can be heard.